non so cosa vuol dire le voci di petto.
Beh, dovrebbe un cantante servirsi?
No. Se c'è una cosa naturale, sì. Se vengono, ci sono quelle cantanti, specie del secolo scorso, che hanno studiato in una chiave che lo dicono di petto, ma perché era l'epoca in che loro studiavano così. Ma io non so neanche cosa vuol dire una voce, una emissione di petto.
Non esiste voce di petto. Sfido chiunque a dirmi che esiste una voce di petto.
Beh, risonanza di petto.
Beh, no, una risonanza non è una risonanza di petto, perché se lei per esempio mi fa un suono, per esempio, oh, questo è di petto, perché qui invece, oh, questo è in maschera, quello è giusto, questo no. Sul capo mio le chiome sento drizzarsi ancor, drizzarsi ancor, drizzarsi ancor. Vedi, tutto questo non è appoggiato di petto. Sembra di petto, ma non lo è.
Dovrebbe un cantante servirsi della voce di petto?
No, non deve mai. La voce di petto viene una voce sforzata, non è più una voce naturale. Quando ci fa... è sul fiato.
Sì.
Invece tanti fanno... Questa è notte di petto.
Allora,
no good.
Nel Falstaff lei non ha mai usato la voce di petto?
Mai.
Come la Quickly?
Questa non è voce di petto, è voce sul sostegno del fiato.
Erano tutti contro l'usanza della voce di petto.
Proprio loro?
Sì.
Proprio loro che per tutta la vita hanno usato la voce di petto?
per esempio, loro tutte ci hanno mostrate, hanno mostrato degli esempi ed hanno sempre evitato l'usanza della voce di petto.
Loro. Beh, si vede che si sono, hanno la memoria corta.
le trova...
Ma se la Quickly della Barbieri ancora adesso è tutto di petto?
Dice di no.
Come di no?
Beh, per esempio, ci ha cantato anche una parte della Quickly senza voce di petto.
Ma adesso abbiamo detto la Barbieri, ma se la, perché l'ha nominata lei, è una mia carissima amica ed è una grande cantante, ma lei se sente la voce della Barbieri anche nella norma, lei esattamente vedrà che tra la parte bassa, la tessitura bassa e la tessitura alta, c'è un salto di cambiamento di colore, molto, molto evidente. Non è che si passa da un passaggio all'altro senza che uno se ne accorga, voglio dire. È talmente evidente che lei faceva le note di petto e poi improvvisamente sbiancava la voce e andava sull'acuto. Tutti i contralti l'hanno sempre fatto, è una cosa naturalissima.
Io ho intervistato alla Cerquetti.
Aveva una bella voce, quella, ma apriva troppi suoni.
Alla Barbieri.
Sì.
Alla Dami Corradetti.
Bella voce anche lui.
All'Olivero.
All'Olivero.
Sì, eccetera, eccetera. Con l'eccezione della Ganger, erano.
Brava.
Erano tutte contro l'usanza della voce di petto, che io invece trovo indispensabile.
Indispensabile, sono degli ignoranti. Mi scusi. sono degli ignoranti. Allora come fa? Ma guardi che l'Olivero le metteva le voci di petto, sa? Se le metteva pur di avere il successo.
Mattino si carica in casa e fuori. Must have those songs too, eh? It's very wrong when they say that you don't have your low notes, the more you have your high notes. It's wrong. In the bel canto, you have to have the chest notes, the passage, and the top notes. It is what they call bel canto, is a schooling, it's a way, the only way to sing. That's the way the old Lili Lehmanns, who were German, the old Malibran, Pasta, they used to sing that way. They had chest notes.
Well, hello, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Actually, more ladies today than ever. I can't begin to say how happy I am to be making this video. It's been wandering my mind forever, but somehow I just never took the chance, really. So today's the day. We are going to be talking about the female voice and how do we develop it, how do we treat it. So, you know, for the occasion, so I'm wearing a shirt and the whole shebang, being all academic. Also because this video has tons of, how could I say this, external material. Why? Because in order to teach a voice, you must research the voice, and that's what I did back in the day. And obviously, you know, I heard McRae teaching women, female voices, during my entire period of time. And obviously, not only that, I also, you know, attended lessons with Adrian Thompson, Sue McCulloch, Paul Farrington, and the whole shebang. But basically, whilst I was staying at McRae's, for all those years, I would stay, and I would listen to how he trained female voices, and especially, you know, we had this this diva, right? It was Eva Maria Westbrook, and I'll attach some footage of her early days. Now, how could I begin this? Male and female voices, yin and yang. That's why it's so extraordinary about them and teaching them, working with them, because it's such a mystery. The best part of it is that they cannot, as a male teacher, they cannot copycat you, they cannot imitate you, and thus the sound is, I don't know, extremely organic and very original, very how is the word, genuine, if I may say. So this video is divided into some parts. You know, I always improvise them. I'm gonna make a slight intro about, you know, differences between male and female voices, and then I'm gonna go deep into the series of interviews that Jerome Heins conducted whilst he was writing the famous book Great Singers on Great Singing in 1982, New York Limelight Editions. Why? Because at this point, what I've done is I have picked up the most relevant pieces of text during those interviews. In this case, two female singers. This is a great example of how singers say one thing and they do a totally different one. That interview is divided into pro chest voice sort of female singers and against. And you're going to see that there's a huge controversy and contradictions among their opinions. You know, for each singer, I will introduce the singer plus a piece of video, and then I'll start to go into the interview. But mind you, my research has, as always, gone towards the other direction. I've tried to go back to the roots and sort of research the genealogical, the teachers, right? Who did these famous singers learn to sing with, and their teachers try to make a connection to see, okay, this is why, you know, she's saying that thing and she's doing that thing or a different one. It has not always been possible. You know, you lose the tracks. It's like, you know, and one has only so many books, and the internet can only offer so much. But I did my best. Okay, so with further ado, let's begin. What are the main differences between the male and the female voices? Basically, a male voice will typically fall, we're talking about speaking voice, between an A2 and a C3, which is considered a lower pitch. And females, on the other hand, work in a higher pitch. That's usually A3 to C4. Thus, see the octaves. This is a whole octave, and that's why when you see literature, you know, you're gonna see that usually male and female voices, everything is an octave lower. There is a small crossover between male and female voices, and this explains why some male singers have like high pitched singing voices. You know, this is the case of the tenor, for example. Now, why is that? And again, this is only science and anthropology and all those studies. I'm not particularly fond of that stuff, but here we go. Well, evolution studies suggest that men, apart from their anatomy, obviously we have to take into account the anatomy, and yet again, everybody is different and every voice is different, but sort of speak to make things a bit stereotypical for simplistic reasons or, you know, goals. Over time, male evolved to have deeper voices, basically for survival purposes. Lower voices suggest a dominance, as males are more intimidated by rivals. In what we call low-pitched voices, this sort of color, the deeper it is, the more sort of intimidating it might be. In the respect, and just out of my mind, Liam Neeson, right? I will find you, right? I will, right? That sort of that threat. I will find you. I will kill you, and I will whatever. Thomas Shelby, right? Those are all baritones. Anyway. Where the resonance occurs, well, I would say, and contrasting with all these studies, that the male main resonance is the pharynx, and I would say that the female main resonance is sort of the vocal tract, and I would say the upper part of the pharynx, and then all that cranium area. And why do I say this? Because although chest voice has been predominant in the old Italian school of singing, it is true, according to all scientific papers, most of them, that the chest voice is stronger in males and weaker in females, and the head voice is stronger in females and weaker in males. What is in between? Well, a sort of a mixed voice. Yeah. Now, we will resort to Garcia about this, and I will place a picture of the 1911 edition of his book, Hints on Singing. And thus we see the different, I would say, I don't know, registers, whatever you want to call it, colors. Now, for me, this makes total sense. So the pharynx is the main resonator for both male and female. However, since the male voice is deeper because of all the reasons we said before, and the anatomy of the phonatory system, Thus, we have the predominance of chest voice as the major vehicle, okay, for phonation. I could go on into sort of, you know, the different passaggi or breaks and all that, but to be honest, this is a lot of mumbo jumbo, and since every voice is unique, I'm not gonna go very deep into that. If you guys wanna read Richard Miller, you're gonna find that, I don't know, sopranos, you know, they talk about a primo passaggio, secondo passaggio, and sometimes even a terzo passaggio, so first, second, and third, and you go like, wow, they have this back and forth about chest voice, mixed voice, strong mix, and whatever. For me, it's too much. And with McRae, I just learned basically two things. For male, basically, it was like chest voice, open, and cover. And for female voices, there was chest voice and head voice. And he never talked about mixed voice. Now, I do believe that there is an area, as Garcia said before, that it is sort of mixed. However, what happens usually is that, I don't know, from World War II up to these days, especially these days, there has been a sort of a predominance of women abandoning their chest voices way too soon and going into this sort of head resonance or head voice way down. Where did this passaggio from this chest to this head voice commonly occur, give or take, if you were a soprano, mezzo, or alto, which are really, you know, hard to find? That happened around either B flat, B 4, and obviously that got a bit tighter as you ascend all the way to that B, that E, excuse me. How could I explain this? McRae always said that on B natural, somehow the harmonics changed. I never really paid attention to the lower part of my voice, thus ignoring the first sort of break, if there was any. But he would say that, and the only thing we sort of had to do is to affondare a little bit more around the sound. That for me basically happened around C, sometimes C sharp, rounding the sound, and then covering for a tenor basically around F, F sharp, sometimes G. We could sing open up to B flat if we wanted, but it wasn't a great idea, but a survival one. So again, we go that here we have Richard Miller saying chest, middle or mixed, lower middle, upper middle, head, flageolet, and for us and these great singers, there was only chest, head, and then in the middle it was like middle or mixed. And that mix could go from B flat to E, or sometimes even to F, and then head voice. Now, what is head voice in this sense? This is a parasympathetic resonance. So the feeling of the voice resonating in the cranium instead of in the pharynx. And I will demonstrate some stuff. Obviously, when we're talking about a mezzo is the same as with a baritone. We gotta take it basically a third lower in a way, or sometimes even more, sometimes even less. I learned from McRae that, hey, you know, you gotta learn how to sing open or chesty or whatever you wanna call it as high as you can to strengthen the whole system, and then you start mixing, covering. So basically what happens to a tenor, right? Because that's the only way I can demonstrate. I could demonstrate as well what happens to a baritone around this area of F and F, G. Some people, again, they talk about that it starts happening on E flat. It's too soon. It would be this scale. This scale could be sang totally open. La! And that would be sort of a, you know, risking something. Or you could, around here. La! So this is what is happening to the female voice way down from basically, I would say, either A, right? So here, this is way too much, so basically it's this. Now, I cannot take this and imitate or impersonate what would happen in this pitch because it's way too high. It's going to an E flat. For me, it would be an E flat 5. For a woman, would be it's an E flat 4. For me, it would be an E flat 5, but I cannot sort of imitate that E flat 5 without like breaking my voice, and it's not my voice. But basically, I can do this B flat and this B natural for sure, C as well. But it would be as if I'm doing this sound, and females do it lower here, and that is A B flat B, and then that would continue that sort of strong mix. Which is a high C for me, that would be a middle C for them, and then continue a bit more, much that I can't, right? And then all of a sudden, oh! So for us, basically, oh! Now, this for men is weak. Oh! This sort of falsetto head voice, whatever you want to call it, is weak. But in a woman, after that mixed passage, this mixed voice that blooms like a rocket, is a bomb. Okay, so I don't know if I made myself clear. I hope so, 20 minutes into the video, but this is exactly what happens to males out there. Males do it higher, in a way lower, but if you sort of see the scale, you see the notes, it's lower, okay? That's it. Once you get a hang of it, you go for it. Another thing that I want to clarify is that when these famous female singers, they talk about sometimes this sort of out of focus chest voice, they're talking about open, like going open way too high. And I do agree. I totally agree. But I think there is a big confusion between what chest voice and what is not chest voice or chest resonance. I don't care. Obviously, it doesn't resonate on your or in your sternum, but basically it is pharyngeal, and that's a must. Okay, so without further ado, let's start with Régine Crespin. So, Régine Crespin was born in 1927, sadly passed away in 2007, was a French singer, and basically her period is 1950-1989, sort of contemporary. And she started singing roles in the dramatic soprano and spinto dramatic repertoire, drawing a particular acclaim singing Wagner and Strauss. So hey, this was a hell of a voice, this big chunky voice. Again, she is in the category pro chest, pro pharynx. Who did she study with? Well, she studied under Paul Cabanel and Louis Forestier. In my research, I have found that Paul Cabanel was a baritone born in Oran in 1891 and passed away in Paris in 1958. It is very important, the chronology, to see what was available at the time and what was passed on. Okay, then Louis Forestier was born in 1892, died in 1976, and he was a French conductor, composer, and pedagogue. Mind you, in order to make this video, I have dealt with papers in English, in French, in Italian, in German, in Dutch, in Portuguese. It's like, okay, it's been quite a lot poured into this. And I will go straight into the interview that Jerome Heins performs. And her answer, you know, when he asks, do you use chest voice? Basically, she goes, you know, in France years ago, everybody was against singing chest. And since chest was a taboo, nobody taught how to smooth out that troublesome passage, right? When I'm talking about that mixed voice or the middle that Garcia states. You were only supposed to use head voice, thus avoiding the problem. It's exactly what I just said. I said at the beginning, it's like females going into head voice way too soon. Male singers covering way too soon. Voice becomes really hoody and lacks power. Well, it's a bit like that. And all of a sudden, it says chest voice is the speaking voice. Yeah, it's what we call modal voice. Jerome Heins saying, I've heard many mezzos really sound as if they were yodeling as they went from chest to head and bark. Back, sorry, bark is exactly what you do when you cover. And she replies, well, that's terrible. How can you overcome this problem? And again, she goes, leaving the larynx open, which is basically just tilting and allowing things to happen, is the balance between the chiaro and scuro. So there's a lot of chiaro, but balancing it out, otherwise you're gonna spread in the aperto, but being careful to keep the soft palate high, remember, and that's the oscuro, that's the cover. And you can find this on pages 81, 82. And all of a sudden he launches this, like, do you feel a chest voice is more relaxed, less in the mask? And he said, yes, but it has to be connected always with the mask. Now, for somebody such as, you know, they're talking about open, cover, chiaroscuro and all that, this mask thing starts to go, oh, get out of here. Well, what about if I told you that if you go to the mask from back to front and not from front to back, then it makes sense, keeping that soft palate high and that larynx tilted. There's no issue with that. The issue is to go directly here, at least my humble point of view and that of many others. So, you know, sometimes he said, I start in the high register and the breathing is not so easy. He goes into breathing, never mind. But once you cover, basically, it relaxes me for going up. You can't really sing chest without relaxing, can you? Absolutely not. You push. So basically, we're talking about this. That is C3 for a tenor. Obviously, I cannot push that. That is F. And again, it's not my note, but yes, it is very relaxed. Now, many people discard this sound, and females, that depending on the voice, is gonna happen slightly higher, obviously, it's eight notes higher, but again, the range varies from soprano, mezzo, and alto. Some people discard it. Now, let's move on into the next pro chest singer, Gilda Cruz-Romo.
Thank you.
operatic soprano. And last time I checked, she was born in 1940 and still with us, which is great news. She's particularly associated with dramatic roles in the Italian repertoire. Aida, Tosca, you know. She studied in Mexico City under Ángel Esquivel. Now, Ángel Esquivel was an actor, was a Mexican actor and singer, as well as a pedagogue, born in 1882 and passed away in 1967, who is a baritone. And there goes on the, you know, with the interview. One should begin with chest voice as a base and then building the rest. She began like that. Wow. Well, hello. That's McRae's teaching and approach, and not that of McRae alone. I believe anybody that that you know, it's involved in the a fondo will begin with this. That's the basis. Why? Because the pharynx is the main resonator, and after that, you find where it releases. Chest voice is a meaty sound. It has a more open feeling. Well, there you go. Aperto, chiaro. The talking voice is the chest voice. When you teach a beginner, you say, talk to me. Then, now, sing that way. This just reminds me so much of Melocchi and actually Pari de Venturi stating what Melocchi used to tell him in this parlato rinforzato, this sort of supported speaking voice. Well, here you go. We have it with Gilda Cruz-Romo stating the very same concepts. Then you must round the sound. You must round the sound out, or, you know, mellow it. It must be covered. Wow. There you go. There you go. So one of the great singers of the past with such a voice stating this open cover. And then you must not force the chest up, not open way too high. This is a wide voice. There you go. If you do, you will not be able to carry that force, the potence to the high notes. What it comes to say, it happens with all my students when they discover that their chest voice, their head voice, and they use the set of the chest voice to actually produce their high notes in head voice, obviously, the power multiplies. The voice blossoms. Is absolutely amazing. And usually this exercise that for men is actually quite weak, this sort of head voice that you go here on an F, for example, for a female, you go, for a man would be la la ooh. That for a female would be the equivalent of going something like this. Honestly, like this. La, ah! Something like that would be the equivalent in power as, you know, male, female. This would be already an EF for a female. In head voice, it's different. Okay. It says, I heard some singers say that chest is too dangerous to use. And her answer is, that is because they haven't learned to mix the chest with the head. Never learned to cover. She said empathically. Maybe it's not for everybody, but, well, and they apparently laughed. Says, I am spinto, and when I sing with a big orchestra, it is necessary to use chest voice mixed to cut through the sound. So she's not saying, I need more mask, I need more chest to make the voice rounder, thicker, bigger, and actually freer. Chest must be used gently. I can say it enough, you know, pages 91, 92. Well, Gilda just stated what I said during the last, I believe it was last video, and I said, tread softly. Yeah, but where? With what? With your chest resonances and once you cover, and when you sing both open and cover, and using different, you know, resonances. It's not about pushing, it's not about spreading, but it's about using, you know, all this instead of just, I don't know, this. You're losing a lot of your capabilities. Okay. Beverly Seals. Beverly Seals, May 25, 1929, July 2, 2007, was an American operatic soprano. And again, her stardom was from the 50s until the 70s. And although she sang basically light repertoire at the beginnings, the Handel, Mozart, then she swift onto big roles, Puccini, Massenet, Verdi. She was especially renowned for her coloratura. So you can be coloratura, all of a sudden everybody thinks that is a very light voice, like soubrette, and you know, everybody falls into that box of soubrette. And mind you, I've had quite a few sopranos that came as a soubrette, and all of a sudden within months they came out a proper lyric soprano. Why? Because again, they were using half of their voices. The tip of the iceberg had just started to appear. Who was her teacher, or her teachers actually? Well, her main teacher was Estelle Liebling, April 1880, September 1970, who was an American soprano composer, arranger, and then of course a renowned vocal coach. Now, who was her teacher? Here we go. Now we're gonna go back in time. Matilde Marchesi, born Graumann, born in 1821, died in 1913. It's a German mezzo-soprano, singing teacher, and a proponent of the bel canto method. What does that mean? Chest voice is very important. And the teacher of Matilde Marchesi was Manuel García II, so Manuel García Jr. There you have the legacy. From Marchesi to Estelle Liebling, and then we have Beverly Seals. Now we go to the interview. So then you didn't use chest voice. I didn't begin to use it until I sang Constanza in The Abduction, and I had to go to a G below middle C. I used it for dramatic purposes. Then say, when I went into the bel canto repertoire, so there we go, so bel canto emphasized chest voice, I began to use my chest voice higher than I had never ever used it before, up to an F or F sharp. Hello. Which is very dangerous. Well, it really depends if you're splattering the sound, or you're, you know, forcefully singing that, as I did in the scale, right? Like, that would be sort of animalistic, you know, to blast G's like that through and through in an opera. That's a more noble way of doing it. But this is referring to that. So sometimes, maybe for dramatic purposes, you would blast those things open, obviously in her tessitura. If you are interested in reading what she says exactly, it's on page 305 of that famous book. Marilyn Horn. Now again, I believe you all know who these people are. However, I'll put everything in the description so you can go and search the videos and all that, okay? But for me, the most important thing is not these famous singers and what they said, but who did they study with, and does it correspond to what they were actually doing? Saying and doing are not always the same thing. And monkey sees, monkey does, is not always the best result. So Merlin Horn, born in 1934, and last time I checked in her biography, she's still with us, happily, American mezzo-soprano, specialized in coloratura, so you know, Barbieri and all this Rossini stuff. She studied under William Bernard, 1909-1971 in Los Angeles, and he was an American vocal pedagogue who devoted his life researching the human voice. It's apparently a very sort of a precedence in what is human anatomy and physiology related to singing. Now, who did he study with? Alan Lindquist in 1955. In 1967, Venard published his book Singing, the Mechanisms and the Technique. And this is where it all makes sense. Including in the book, there is an exercise he studied with Lindquist. So again, we're talking about William Bernard, teacher of Merlin Horn. So the teacher of William Bernard was Alan Lindquist. Gave him an exercise, the Cuperto exercise apparently. And the important thing is that the original source of this exercise was Manuel Garcia. And it was later taught by Flagstaff's teacher, Dr. Gillies Brad. There you go. And apparently this work is responsible for helping create some of the greatest singers of the century, including Brigitte Nielsen, Busey Berling, Brigitte Sveden, and Flagstad. You know, there you go. So it all makes sense in a way. It all makes sense. For me, at least, and for those that share my view. I have the ability to color my voice in so many ways, Merlin Horn says. In the famous break area, I don't even consider a problem. I can sing in a head resonance, I can sing in a chest resonance, 50-50, whatever. So pages 139, 140. Many sopranos say they never touch chest voice if they can help it, which is crazy. They're afraid because teachers do not know how to teach it. The chest voice should be taught and sopranos should have it. Page 141. I know this has been a super long video, and I don't know if editing it I'll have to cut things out or whatnot. But honestly, I really had to do it. I really had to make it. Because I always talk about male voices and especially tenors. But that does not mean that one should not focus on that female spectrum. So for all you ladies that, you know, I haven't done any videos regarding the female voice, I went into a controversy of chest voice and the difference between those singers of the past and those of today and what has happened and why McRae was a great believer in taking the chest voice up high and then covering it, thus making that middle voice that you ladies have the best of both worlds. Once again, if you liked the video, like and subscribe. If you didn't, don't watch it by any means, and if you need help, you know where I am. Have a great evening. Bye.